Madam Edith, like I've said, and we are giving ourselves a few minutes and they can get started. Okay, so as we get started, before we introduce our panelists today, we have a quick poll which you can all look through and just click on the right option so that you can paint a picture of what kind of audience we have. The questions are simple, kindly run through and then submit so that we can give a feel to our presenter, even to the people in the audience, so that you can get to know the kind of audience that we're interacting with. Okay, we are starting with the first question. Okay, I believe we should be winding up with the poll. We should be winding up with the poll so that you can be able to run it quickly in a few. Okay, thank you, Derek. And we have the first session, the first poll, the first question. The highest percentage of the people in the audience are between 31 to 50 years. That is good. And then you also have the highest percentage of the people are employed in the private sector. We also have the highest percentage, that is 67 of the individuals owning a small business. That's nice. We have the highest percentage of 83. Of people who have taken business loans. And then it comes to questions, do you have any plans to borrow in the near future? Yes, you have 100% people saying yes. Do you have enough knowledge on how to manage your loans? You have the highest percentage saying no, that is 67. Have you attended a loans management training before? We have the highest percentage saying 67. And then the last question, which is, if yes, indicate who organized the training. Then we have employer and savings group taking the hugest share of this, as well as the institute has taking also 33% actually. So today, like I said, we are pleased to have Madam Edith Tosubira, who is the Executive Director for Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority, that is UMRA, and she possesses over 20 years experience in the field of financial investment risk analysis and project management and administration, 15 years of senior management responsibilities and experience enriched in the area of where she worked as the country manager of OICO Credit and International Financial Investment Organizations, as well as for 13 years, where she has been at the helm of the country's operations. Edith is a fellow of the Association of the Chartered Institute of Certified Accountants, that is called the FCCA. She also has continuously involved in the financial inclusion agenda, which has also developed into full-grown interest of helping other people's increased access to finance. Upon engagement with various stakeholders with the financial sector space, Edith has also learned how to overcome the usual challenges, issues, and efficiencies encountered so as to develop a solid financial system. She has also practically built experience regarding how to solve the underlying issue and concerns within the financial sector. Edith has also worked with the Opportunity Bank, and she has risen from the ranks of officer up to bank manager, that is in treasury section. So we are glad to host Madam Edith this evening. As you can hear, she has a very rich profile, and this topic, I'm pretty sure that all of us are so passionate about it. When you talk about matters of women in the area of finance, like we've heard, she has been so passionate in the area of inclusion, and this also calls on the aspect of women to be included in the financial services sector space. And part of the financial services product also includes savings, loans. And as we're going to be hearing from Edith, we take this pleasure to welcome you. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Benedict. I'm glad to be here this evening to speak to and on the subject of high level interest on our side, but specifically for me as an individual, I am a concerned member of the society in as far as financial inclusion is concerned. For us to be able to have this agenda move in this country, which is likely, of course, the sole objective of which is to ensure that we change the financial situation of our people, this subject is very interesting. Thank you for welcoming me on board. I know there is a CEO of the Uganda Institute, Bankers Institute and Financial Services, the Uganda Institute of Banking and Financial Services continues to confuse me, Madam Masade. I know there's so Benedict and the rest of members out there. I don't know who's listening, but I saw the age group, all protocol observed. Ladies and gentlemen, I am Edith Tosubira, Executive Director, Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority. At such a time like this, it requires real commitment for us to be able to sit here and be able to discuss the matters in our society. I have been at the helm of this institution, the Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority, and I believe so seriously that it was by divine arrangement that I am here today. It has given me the space to understand the microfinance sector in this country even more. I was particularly interested in seeing circle development in the country, But much as I have always been a supporter from credit side, I never knew the challenges embedded under regulation. I'm so appreciative of the opportunity for government to allow me to be at the helm of this solid and very important institution in our country. The reason why I'm here today is to discuss the matter of women empowerment, empowering more women to take credit for investment. Fellow ladies, we are always out there and wondering whether we can be encouraged in this society where we know that it respects men more than women. Most of what is available on the credit side in terms of facilitation tends to favor more of men than women. Historically, even such jobs like boardroom occupation was for men, until today when you start seeing that women can also play a role. The institution that I head as a lady is in the financial space, while the institution of Uganda Banking and Financial Services is also headed by a lady. That therefore means that ladies, given an opportunity, they can try their best. The outline for this presentation will give us the introduction. It will give us what are the benefits of women in economic empowerment. We shall discuss the role of UMRA to women empowerment. And we shall very quickly go to the challenges faced by women to access credit. And ladies and gentlemen, allow me to inform you that it is good for us to have a way forward. And that way forward should be able to allow us to change the space. As you have already in the preamble, you heard very well what the discussant Benedict said. It just means that we need to change something. Something must work. Something must change. The question comes to us, what is women empowerment or economic empowerment? It's the ability to build, develop, and manage systems of credit and finance by increasing access to financial products and services and enabling increased participation and voice in the way products and services are provided. This includes benefits from the revenues created. You realize that women have always been left on the side, on the wayside. And the past 30 years, or maybe you can call it 25 to 30 years, is continuing to prove that it is important for us to get the women out there, get involved in the financial services. I am sure you have heard commonly heard people say, when you give it to a woman, it will be handled in a ladylike way. It means that we have shown the society that naturally we are careful. There is no other gender that is as endowed as a woman to handle, especially finances. I therefore want to continuously call on women to get involved. Let us not leave these things for others, in this case, the men. The men have been there, they have played their part, they are continuing to be there. I mean, let us all get involved. And gender does not necessarily mean you exclude. It's actually, if you think through, just means involve as much as you can. What are the benefits for women economic empowerment? Ladies, I believe, and gentlemen who are here, it is so important to set the the path towards gender equality. We have to be able to involve everyone so that we can be able to achieve or benefit from the advantages of each gender. We can be able to eradicate poverty if we get the woman involved, because these are the mothers of our land. And of course, at the end of the day, we get inclusive growth, economic growth. Women make enormous contributions to economies if they are involved. Let us educate them, and so that they can get involved in our businesses. The gentlemen, don't leave your wives just at home, although they work at home. Don't leave us just on the farms, because sometimes we are looked at as just machines. Women can actually be entrepreneurs. They have proved that one. Only what we require is to get them financially literate. Women can actually be very good employees, given responsibility. So let us just not involve them, because women have proved themselves when it comes to doing unpaid care work at home. I think they have done a great job. This therefore means that we can get these benefits tapping into the other areas, especially in the areas of financial involvement and literacy, and the actual activity where money is moving from one hand to another. The question would be, do we buy and sell? Women can buy and sell better. Excuse me. This therefore can lead to credit accessibility and improved women's welfare, the family, and the society at large. I know women for sure, given an opportunity, they can do a lot. I've been around, as you heard, more than 25 years of experience in the microfinance sector state. I have discovered that a big role, a large one, has been played mainly by women. At the entry of microfinance in this nation, around, I don't quite remember, but in the early 90s, when microfinance had just come, it is the women who did the donkey work. But when they were given those small loans, today, these are big institutions. I can name them. We have institutions like Pride Microfinance. We have institutions like Finance Trust Bank, Yugaford, and these are your members today. But some of us know the history. The major one is Centenary Bank. I don't think I can talk of Centenary Bank being started by women. Only one financial institution I know focused on women, and it was started by women, that is Finance Trust Bank. I know they have good shareholding in that institution, which is today a bank. It demonstrates very well the fact that if women are empowered, they can do something about it. I have dealt directly and indirectly with some of these institutions, and I can tell you that if I was allowed to do some statistics, a lot of them have been grown, and they've grown because of women. So I would like to request that we continue with women empowerment so that we can get increased financial inclusion. I also promised to talk about the role of UMRA, our contribution to women empowerment as UMRA. Of course, there are so many areas where we have contributed, but UMRA is responsible for regulating, licensing, and supervising the Tier 4 sector. That is the microfinance institutions and money lenders. They also include SACCOs. They include non-deposit taking microfinance institutions and self-help groups and all other money lenders. And what have we done with these? We have promoted legitimacy and building the confidence of members and customers in the microfinance sector. By this, all we are trying to create is when they allow to be regulated and licensed, then we follow up. We've been trying to manage the challenges therein involved. You know, our society has continuously been challenged by the mushrooming money lenders that have not been under a lot of control. And so it created mayhem. You know, the history of a lot of savings that has been taken from the different institutions that come up, some of them below the table organizations. We try to look for those ones. We also create existence of consumer protection. This we have done mainly through the complaints handling mechanism, whereby organizations that we work with, we allow them to come and do some reporting. In that process of reporting, we have been able to put together lenders and borrowers. Those concerned about transparency, we have handled that one. The process of complaints handling has helped us to reach out to the customers of the regulators so that we can understand deeply what the issues are about and we get to solve them. We also are supposed and we are in the process of going to manage what they call the SACCO Savings Protection Fund. And this scheme is only about securing savings. We are working so hard to put mechanisms around that so that all the SACCOs that we shall be licensing shall have a way of us regulating the savings that they are in, not in terms of any other thing. We are interested in making sure that they remain secure. And here I want to quickly say that we have encountered abuse where different managers and SACCO committees have connived and run away with members' savings. So the intention of Tier 4 Act 2016 is to solve that vice. So our regulations are extending a hand on trying to put people to account for members' savings. So gone will be the days where a manager will pack savings and get away with it. I think that one we are going to follow very, very keenly. We also issued, in the process of concluding the operational guidelines to assist us manage self-help groups. These are, for example, the VSLAs. What do we do with them? We are trying to create a scenario where they report, not because we want to know how much money they have so that we can have maybe access to it. No, the intention is to ensure that there is discipline among those members who come together. Currently, what's happening out there, there are some places, especially rural-based organizations, whose members are majorly women. They are robbed day and night. They keep their money, and at the end of the day, because of the loose systems, that money disappears and members never benefit. So we are creating some financial stabilization mechanisms so that we can follow up on what's happening with that money. And we also promote women membership in this process. And we also create leadership, as in we are able to follow and support those women who are willing to be leaders. Ladies and gentlemen, it's because when women are empowered, they can give you a difference. And I just want to continue by saying that we also promote programs and interventions that are necessary for development of the Tier 4 institutions. And these include financial literacy programs, to help the public understand the financial components and skills such as budgeting, investing, borrowing, personal financial management, among others. I think I really want to appreciate government for coming up with a way of regulating the services of Tier 4 sector. All these circles out there, if we continue regulating them, I can only promise that we shall have a full-grown financial sector in Uganda. Because, ladies and gentlemen, most of our money is kept under Tier 4. These institutions, circles, self-help groups, VSLAs, all those, if we know what's happening there, and then we are helping those to counter those vices, as I've already mentioned, we shall be able to get women empowerment. And I have told you before that women have played a role in this. Women don't fear starting small. Most of these organizations are small, but with time you start finding them with very serious money, all because they've been able to come together, all because of financial inclusion. Now, government planning to have UMRA regulate such institutions was a plus. And I think if we continue to exist and we continue to do what we are supposed to do, I can promise you, I have seen it work. I have seen it done in Kenya. When they came up with their SASRA, which is their UMRA, they started following up what was the devices which were existing in circles, in their circle development system. And today, their circles have grown. They've only needed discipline, and all is now going on, I think, in a more controlled and organized way. So I will just continue to implore all organizations out there, if you are a circle, the Tier 4 Act says that if you use the word circle, then you must be licensed by Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority. And if you are not therefore regulated, very soon you might be asked to rub off the word circle, meaning I don't know what you call yourself. But the most important is, if we are to improve on transparency, if we are to work on issues like know your client, we need a license. And the license can only be provided according to our laws by Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority. All women out there, for us as UMRA, we can only give you the space. We give you a license and we give you the space. We are giving this space to different financial players to be able to come and act. Because when we say we license money lenders, meaning all money lenders, that whoever wants to bring money, whether foreign or locally generated, they are supposed to be licensed by Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority. Now, in this case, it is not only women, but Tier 4 sector, if we are to take a census, is largely the players are women. So I encourage you to continue. However, all this does not go without any challenges. So there are challenges faced by women to access credit. But before I even delve into those challenges, I want to continue encouraging the financial sector and the members specifically of Uganda Institute of Banking and Financial Services to ensure that women are given an extra hand, try to pick interest in detail of what are we going to do with women? Can we create something a little bit extra? I know some financial institutions that are giving some bonuses for women so that women can continue in the space of financial development and literacy and etc. financial services. I therefore request that those who are who will hear these challenges and you have access to doing something about it, that you start putting within your products those things that can enable women to participate in a more inclusive manner. And so as I continue, challenges faced by women entrepreneurs in Uganda face many challenges when they are on the path to set their enterprise. That means that when it comes to setting up institutions, our enterprises of women, women-led, they struggle. You take long to believe us. They take too long to believe our story. And yet we are the most committed and transparent when it comes on the other side. These challenges, however, range from many stigmas and misconceptions that are created to institutional challenges. Now I've addressed the institutional challenges, but there are some women who have ended up believing that for them they are the weaker ones. And so when they start feeling so weak, they end up even making their businesses become weak. That reduced confidence to access credit due to existence of social attitude, because we are in a patriarchal society, in a system that believes that men are better than women. I know that some of you have been told that men are better than women. Now I'm here to tell you that it is not the case. Don't believe it and you find yourself somewhere else. In the financial sphere, women entrepreneurs are often patronized by their peers, that is the men, and this affects business decision making. Constant exposure to such behavior may prompt an enterprising woman to second guess herself, which is never good for any business person. I mean, we have to go above stereotypes. We should be able to know that, supposing you are given a responsibility, do it and handle it and believe that you can also do it like a man. Those guys have blood like we do. And I'm not here about women emancipation. I'm just talking about the natural gifts given to women. Networking is also a problem for women entrepreneurs in society dominated by men in economic, social, and political spheres. I believe you have seen and you have also encountered some women in leadership, and you know that if women are given an opportunity, they can create a difference. In most cases, women entrepreneur is also expected to manage household, which puts them to a disadvantage in competition with male counterparts. Right now, I am still in office and I am giving a talk about women empowerment, but I'm supposed to be in the kitchen ensuring that my family is taken care of. Thank God I have a good partner who helps me. But some women don't have that much opportunity. They will find a gentleman who's their husband, who starts now to make a lot of noise and say, why are you not here? Why are you not supposed? You're supposed to be in the kitchen. You're supposed to give me food right now. And it is as immediate as they commit, as they request. So I would like, therefore, to implore the husbands who are out there to understand women and give them a bit more space so that we can share this world. Most financial institutions are not gender responsive. They merely focus on general audience, not tracking women's key needs as a vulnerable population. So we need to put the women's issues at the fore in the different financial institutions where we work. Last but not least is requirements to access credit include collateral securities, which may not be easily accessed by most women. I want to suggest that what has been our role as Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority to try and break this scenario. We know that a lot of our women, especially the rural women, are on farms. All they can show you is their garden. What did we do? We entered into a memorandum of understanding with URSB, Uganda Registration Services Bureau, and we came up with a system called SIMPLE, this system allows organizations to put their collateral that is movable for registration, and so that we can get those people who don't have collateral in form of fixed, like titles, land titles, etc., cars, to just register a garden there, and then it is you're able to access resources. That is a contribution to the women, because they are mostly those who do the tilling on farms. So you don't have to own the land, you only have to own the crops, and you are able to access some funding. What is our way forward, as I try to get to the conclusion? The public therefore needs to consider legit lending to institutions as the only financial services providers. Mm-hmm. There is need for a collaborative effort for continuous encouragement of financial institutions to ensure inclusion of women from inception of their products and services. Gender responsiveness is not a mere mention of women in a document, but a practical role in promoting gender equality. Let us try to work out ways of finding out what is happening and how can we achieve gender inclusion in the financial services and products. Women should look beyond societal expectations and rise above the bar. This will take bold steps, both at individual and institutional level. The major role is supposed to be played by the women themselves. Stop lamenting, we all have same color of blood, men and women. Encourage yourself, get out of the comfort zone, and see yourself moving towards inclusion. Inclusion will leave you by the wayside, and it will be only you as a woman to blame. We are therefore here to encourage our women to get involved in whatever little, start small and increase capacity over time, and it can work. My conclusion will therefore be that together we can help bridge this gap. It is going to involve very many players. It is going to involve commitment. It is going to involve putting understanding together as a society, being very resolute and determined to make things work. I really want to thank those that have been listening to me, and I took note of the fact that most of the people who are on this forum today are age group below 50. I want to encourage you, younger team of people, that is the age where you're supposed to explore. That is the age where you must make things work for you. And I think the future has better things to hold. Thank you so much for listening to me. I appreciate this opportunity, and we are willing as Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority to continue supporting the activities of Uganda Institute of Banking and Financial Services. I know that a lot of our people, our regulators, shall be using the institute so that we can be able to grow together and grow the sector. And so our willingness is still open. Thank you so much for the opportunity. And I say bye.
Wow, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Madam Edith. It has been so insightful, especially on women matters. So passionate about women matters, like I said, from the beginning to the end, it's a woman. From the day we are born, from the day we are raised, even up now, it's a woman. So seeing all these submissions and everything that is taking shape in the country now, having women involved is something that's really something so good, and we all have to implore it. Like you said, men have had their share, they have made their contribution, and they're still making their contribution. And it's good that you're seeing women come up to take on this, the core responsibilities, and as far as the economic development is concerned. So we are now open for questions. I request that those who have questions, post them in this session so that you can have them attended to. Alex from Nairo Microfinance Limited, Arua, you are much welcome. And maybe if you pose a few questions to Madam Edith, if you're still in the call, you've talked of women who have been so instrumental in putting up some microfinances that have actually risen in two banks. So from your side as UMRA, I'm pretty sure you are a regulatory body that is involved in policy formulation. What are some of the strategies that have been put in place or that you're embracing to make sure that we get more financial institutions be supported to take consideration of women? Because if you have to look at the space of the mainstream banking, there's still some challenges that really have to be identified and need to be that Zab mentioned, like the issues of interest rates to be high. And we still have women who are struggling in this lower area of maybe find a woman who is owning a mdala in Kalewe, and they would still need financing. If you have to get a better financing, they have to go into commercial banks. And they would definitely need things like collateral, and they may not have it at hand. So should we envisage some microfinances being given support from the government to maybe subsidize the interest rates, or even maybe to be assisted through these other programs that the government is trying to put up? What are some of the preferential treatments that are being given to women in as far as this area is concerned? Over to you, Madam Edith.
Thank you so much, Sula. You are asking specifically about strategies for more financial institutions to be supported. You and me know very well that right now we are just emerging out of, and we are not even sure whether we have completely gotten out of the COVID era. But as you have heard, that the Minister of Finance has already given us some stimulus package that is, by the way, very small. It means that as a country, we still have to grapple with some of our challenges. Now you want to understand banks, these financial institutions, if they have to support to the level of that woman in the market, whom they yet don't yet know very well because of KYC challenges, what are they going to do? So what we are trying to do about that, for these women to be known, we've decided to come up with a system. We are trying to ensure that all these institutions that we regulate shall end up on a system somewhere. And if we have all those institutions under a system, then we shall be able to improve Know Your Client, KYC systems. And KYC in countries where it has been developed, through, of course, supporting regulation, allows financial inclusion. It promotes increased transparency. There is a track record that is easily helps to reach whoever wants to know that particular client who they are supporting. And so as long as we still have a lot of the unknowns in this space, we shall not easily have financial institutions at the level of banking to support women empowerment. And I also want to think that when we are talking women empowerment, we are not necessarily referring to the woman in the market alone. We are also including both urban and rural women. Even urban women have challenges of financial literacy and access. So when you ask that, are we going to look and subsidize interest rates? Interest rates can only manage themselves, especially if we allow a space to work. If we put all those organizations on a system, they will be able to find those that are charging highly will compete against each other, and competition will edge out those who can't actually, or those who are charging highly. I don't think in this liberal economy, it is very easy for anyone to claim that they are going to control interest rates. However, that responsibility has been given to our minister. In the time when we are ready to explain about, rather to conclude about what to do on interest rates, we shall put our communication across. As of now, we haven't yet started and there's no specific strategy for it. And the only strategy we are putting in place is regulate, supervise, license. If we can do that, you will find that those who have been playing not fairly in the market will reduce. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Edith. I think that has been insightful. And I want to believe that whoever has been having a concern about that question has been answered well. We have someone who didn't mention their names is saying, please give more clarity on investing in USD. That's securities. More clarity on investing in Uganda Securities Exchange. I think that's what they meant. Do you have something to say about that? What would you, in regards to women, what would you encourage? I mean, what would you advise women if it comes to investing in securities, security exchange?
I think that is playing on shares with shares. It is another form of financing and investing. So if you have an institution and it can be at a level of public institution, then you can go and have it registered so you can access to, you can access finance from others. While at the same time, if you have some excess cash and you think you can have it under certain in shares, you can invest in shares, then it is okay. We can encourage that you get there. All that is regulated, by the way. For information, that one is regulated by a Capital Markets Authority. And I think that a lot is improving as well there, because formerly we never had that sector working well in this country, but now there is a regulator. So I think all is well. I would support that you can take your money there as well.
Okay, thank you so much, Edith. I think whoever asked that question, though they didn't mention their names, has been well captured. Do you have any other questions in the chat before we call it off? Or for those who would want to put up their hands, please put up your hand. And you can ask your question. Don't have any questions, Madam Edith, I'll ask you to give your parting shots so that you can conclude to the audience.
The invitation to me was specifically on how to discuss women empowerment. Women empowerment is not a subject to end. Although as we emerge out of COVID, I also think that we can talk largely about business empowerment. I think even businesses belonging to our counterparts, the men, has been affected. So my thinking is we should address also the other side of colleagues, so that we can get a vibrant economy. We need financing to work. We need to control things like inflation. We need to get our people to save more. And I think if we did that, we will find ourselves in a situation that is better than where we are right now. For the fellow women, I can just conclude by saying that please do not feel sorry for yourselves being a woman. Get involved and the world will be different for you and for me. I can only conclude by saying thank you for the opportunity, Uganda Institute of Bankers, Financial Services, Banking and Financial Services, for the opportunity to be able to speak at this forum. Those out there listening to me, thank you for listening up to this time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Edith. Thank you so much from the Ghana Institute of Banking and Financial Services and for having come through to help us in organizing this webinar. We are so grateful for having made of your time to make sure that this webinar has been well facilitated, and of course to thank all our sponsors. This webinar has been organized by the Ghana Institute of Banking and Financial Services in partnership with the Bank of Uganda and Uganda Bank Association. To our partners, that is Equity Bank, Housing Finance Bank, Finance Trust Bank, DFC, UCT Bank, Financial Intelligence Authority, KCB, we have ABSA, we have Mercantile Bank, Exim Bank, Finca, NCBA, Uyghur Food, BRAC, Cairo International Bank, we also have Bank of Africa, we have DTB, we have ABC Capital Bank, Bank of Baroda, as well as Tropical Bank. And to our co-host today, we thank you so much, Umra, for having made of your time to come and be part of this. Otherwise, from me, it's a good night and stay safe. Bye.
Bye.